¿sabes qué? Así te va a salir negro el marco de los lados. Sale bueno, un rectángulo y negro.
Muy buenos días a todas y a todos. Bienvenidas y bienvenidos a esta conferencia magistral de la doctora Chiara Bottici. Quiero dar las gracias específicamente a que la doctora Bottici esté aquí en la Universidad Iberoamericana. Específicamente es un honor para el doctorado en estudios críticos de género tenerla aquí presente, una conferencista con unas ideas novedosas y por supuesto con una conferencia que seguramente va a mover muchísimos pensamientos, muchísimas emociones. La doctora Bottici es doctora en filosofía por el Instituto Universitario Europeo de Florencia, Italia. Fue docente de la Universidad de Frankfurt y ha escrito sobre el feminismo, el anarquismo, la biopolítica, la filosofía social y la política contemporánea. Entre sus publicaciones más recientes se encuentran Per tre miti, Force 4, de 2016, Imaginal Politics, Images Beyond the Imagination and Beyond the Imaginary, de 2014, e Imaging Europe, Myth, Memory and Identity, coescrito con Benoît Chaland en 2013. Coeditó el volumen Feminism, Capitalism and Critic Essays in Honor of Nancy Fraser en 2017 con Banu Bardou y el libro The Anarchist Turn de 2013 con Jacob Blumenfeld and Simon Critchley. Entre sus líneas de investigación están la filosofía moderna, el feminismo, el psicoanálisis, la estética y los estudios poscoloniales. Actualmente es activista y profesora asociada de filosofía en la New School for Social Research de Nueva York, en donde imparte asignaturas como género y dominación y filosofía y literatura. Bienvenida, doctora.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the kind invitation, and it's really an honor to be here, and in particular to bring whatever contribution I can to the beginning of this new great program in critical gender studies, which I will try to also argue in my conference, I think is more important and timely than ever before. Okay, so let me begin with an image. In 2015, the New York State Education Department launched a new disability campaign. In an effort to encourage disabled people to work, the New York State Education Department circulated an advertisement entitled, "Do you have a disability? Do you want to work?" and enriched with a number of images representing presumably people who are likely to have disabilities. What the advertisement says in terms of words is pretty clear, but what I want to do now is to ask, what is being communicated besides words by images themselves? In particular, what is being communicated at what I in the past called the imaginal level, that is images which are both conscious and unconscious at the same time. So what are images openly saying, but what are they also not openly saying, but yet communicating? The image show, beginning from the top right, a Latino construction worker, an African-American student, a possibly Latino middle-class woman who's being helped by another woman, an African-American mechanic in front of a car, and finally, a white but old middle-class woman who's dealing with a computer. For the typical New York subway user, the images cannot but convey a very clear message. Disability is likely to concern racialized working-class bodies, racialized youth, and women, because even when comfortably sitting at a desk, they're still likely to need some help. As you can see, the other two women are also the only one who are being helped, either by a computer or by another woman. And also notice the gaze, old men look straight, old women look somewhere else, presumably towards the source of their help. This is what is visible in the images. Let us now ask, what is invisible, right? What is simply not there? What is absent and yet perhaps conspicuously present? Clearly, there are no white males, no middle-class white males in the entire selection of images. Now, why has it not occurred to the designer of the poster to insert any white middle-class males if it is true as well that actually white middle-class males do benefit from visibility? Perhaps on equal terms of all the others, and perhaps even more. Notice also how race, gender, and class intersect with one another in the image mentioned above. In the top right image, we have both a Latino and a construction worker. Would he be less likely to disability if he had been a white working class man? The young school boy is clearly an African American. Are white youth immune from disability? Last but not least, the only possible white and middle class people are both women. And significantly, both, as I said, are being helped. So are white middle class men really immune from disability and from the need for help? If this is not the case, why has it not occurred to the designer to insert a white middle-class man? And even more so, how is this affecting the image of disability that people who use the New York subway develop at their unconscious level about who are the people who are likely to be disabled? More could be said in that respect, but I hope the major point I wanted to make about the intersectional nature of social discrimination should now be clear. When it comes to representing bodies, and in particular bodies who are likely to be affected by disability, gender, class, and race converge with one another in a way that cannot really be separated. Right? So if the youth represented here, instead of being an African American, had been a white teenager going to school, he would not have been in the campaign, and the message would have been very different. So you can see how these factors really converge. But if it is true that all sources of oppression converge with one another, does it even make sense to speak about feminism? Right? What is so special about women? In this talk, I would like to articulate the need for actually a feminist position, and I would like to do so by first showing the usefulness, but also the limits of the notion of intersectionality, and then move on to argue for what I call an anarcho-feminist research program. Secondly, I will try to provide the philosophical framework for this enterprise by arguing that it is in what I call an ontology of the trans individual, that you can find the conceptual resources for thinking about the plural nature of women's bodies. Third, this will allow me to tackle the question, what does it mean to be a woman in pluralistic terms, and also to defend a specifically feminist form of anarchism. In conclusion, I will go back to the anarcho-feminist tradition of the past and show why I think it's so timely today and why I think is our best possible ally in the pursuit of a critical theory of society. Okay, so first step, intersectionality. There is now a great deal of detailed empirical work showing how different forms of oppression reinforce and sustain one another. At least since the 70s, when feminists started to investigate the way in which the mononuclear family coalesced with other institutions such as schools and factories, the idea of an intersectional model started to emerge. The main side behind this keyword is that if you want to understand how the oppression of women work, we cannot limit ourselves to one single factor, be it gender or race, but we need to investigate the way in which a plurality of such factors converge in order to reproduce the idea of the inferiority of women. To put it bluntly, oppression in general, and the oppression of women in particular, is plural because the world is plural. So we need research programs such as that of intersectionality, which are able to capture this plurality. It is in the attempt to render such plurality that publication titles have started to grow. We go from Davis, 1981, Women, Race, and Class, to Newman, Identities and Inequalities, Intersections of Race, Class, Gender, and Sexuality, which adds to the least important distinction between sex and gender. But it's perhaps only in the last few decades with post-colonial studies that intersectionality blossomed. In particular, post-colonial feminists underline that the emancipation of women from the global north can indeed happen at the expense of more oppression of women in the global south, and therefore push to add another important item to the list, which is empire. Because being a racialized body, but living at the heart of an empire is not like being a racialized body and being outside of the empire. The list, however, did not stop here. Brooke Holmes entitled her work, Marked Bodies, Gender, Race, Class, Age, Disability, and Disease, although she forgot sexuality, which is different from gender, and empire, which as I say is different from race, it goes to her credit for having brought other important items, such as age and disability, and we have seen how age is a factor that impacts her. Yet, is this enough? Why not adding beauty to the list? We know very well how ideas of beauty coalesce also with racial images in order to transmit hegemonic view of femininity. Or we can put fat as another example. Now, I think the problem, indeed, with lists is that any kind of list, so it is really a problem with the notion of intersectionality, is always necessarily incomplete. I mean, there is never a stop to the item that one has to look at in order to understand how oppression works. Furthermore, any list is also necessarily open. People can say, why not fat? Why is nobody in this list of publication mentioning fat as a problem? By naming certain items, any list operates an implicit selection, privileging some factors over others that are left out of it. So to put it bluntly, any list is deemed to tell us at the same time too much and too little. Yet, how to avoid them if you want to render an idea of a plurality? Second, while intersectionality is a good tool to orient empirical analysis, since it prevents any sort of reductionism, there is also the risk of losing something about the specificity of women oppression. If all forms of oppression are meant to intersect with one another, does it even make sense to speak about feminism specifically? If the lists are ever expanding, what is so specific about women? And what do we mean when we say women? Are we not excluding other categories from the list? In particular, can we talk about the specific condition of women and a distinctively feminist position without falling into the trap of heteronormativity or even worse, essentialism? In order to respond to this double criticism, I would like to put forward what I call an anarcho-feminist position. Why anarcho-feminist? Because the idea of anarchism, so a critique that there is anarchy, so a founding principle that explains the subjection of women, is combined with a specifically feminist position. So the idea is that, like intersectionality, you emphasize that you have to, in order to fight the oppression of women, you have to fight all other forms of oppression, right? So racial oppression, economic oppression, and so on and so forth, cultural domination. But at the same time, we have to keep a focus on the position of women, and I will say more about why I think this is the case. So I will try to defend a position that is both feminist and anarchist at the same time, and I will try to do it both at the substantive level and the methodological level. At the substantive level, defending an anarcho-feminist position means arguing that there is no arche, right? It doesn't mean that there is no rule, it doesn't mean that there is pure chaos, it simply means that there is no arche, meaning first principle for the subjugation of women. But at the same time, I think we should also not lose, because some anarchists would argue, why do you want to be a feminist? If you are an anarchist, you are really against all form of domination, so by definition, you are an anarchist. Besides the fact that a lot of anarchists are not feminists, and that although I think there's a tension, theoretical tension, between an anarchist and a misogynist, but there are a lot of anarchists who are misogynists, so that's why we have to keep the two concepts really together. Also, I think that although it's important to question binary, and we have had queer theory which has been doing that in a really great way, I think it's also important, particularly in our condition, to keep a notion of womanhood, because there are bodies who are discriminated because they're perceived as women. And there's even a way, for instance, in artistic years where if you are a queer person, you're paid much more than if you are a woman. Like if you're a woman, cisgender artist, you're the bottom of the scale. I mean, you're not even cool. So I really, part of this project is really trying to vindicate both anarchist side, but also the feminist one. Like there are bodies who are perceived as women bodies, but and precisely on that basis as our object of discrimination. Now, the point is, we have to keep this notion of woman, but at the same time, through our developing an understanding of what it means to be a woman, it doesn't imply father hierarchies, right? First of all, which doesn't imply father hierarchies between, let's say, gender, that conform to the binary men and women, and gender forms that don't conform at all with this. Now, in order to develop this notion of womanhood in a more pluralistic way, and here I move to the second part, I would like to focus on a specific ontology, what I call an ontology of the trans individual, as the more general philosophical framework for this enterprise. Now, I don't know how many of you have had a chance to read the Spanish translation of the paper. Can you just, okay, not everybody. Okay, so in this part, there is a more, let's say, technical, philosophical part of the paper that develops this ontology of the trans individual. And I think part of the subtleties of, and the technicalities are not really needed for the entire paper. I mean, it's a conversion of philosophers, they be like this kind of technicalities, but not everybody is that sick. So I think I can skip that. And I will try to just say in a few words what I mean with an ontology of the trans individual. So the term trans individuality is a term that has been coined by Gilbert Simondon, so a French philosopher, and has later on been used by Etienne Balibar, another French philosopher, to interpret Spinoza's ontology. Okay, what does it mean? Okay, first of all, a lot of people coming right at the trans individual moment, which is very appropriate. So as the trans individual bodies assembled in the room, let me just spell out some of the philosophical presuppositions. I'm not going to go too much into it now, but we can discuss. So first of all, it's a monist ontology. What does it mean by monist? It means that there is no opposition or even separation body and mind. But mind and body are just modes of the same substance. So a body is a mind, and a mind is a body. And in a very weird way, which we can discuss later, this glass also somehow has a mind. Okay. So this is what is meant by monist ontology. There are not two distinct substances, thinking, mental activity, and material extension on the other. Okay. So within this monist ontology, individual things, okay, such as this glass of water or my body, are not individual, and that's why it's called from individuality to trans-individuality, but always trans-individual. Okay. What this means is that every body exists as part of an infinite network of connection. Okay, let's take any individual body here in this room. I think none of you has decided to be born, right? That wasn't your decision, right?
Right.
None of you has decided to be born in one place as opposed to the other, okay? All this is taking place at what we call the supra-individual level, right? So it's not even inter-individual, it's just supra-individual. I happen to be born in Italy, okay? I happen to be born by a decision of somebody else, okay? At the same, so but this, yes, makes a lot of what is my body here. At the same time, my body is also the result of interactivities that take place between different bodies. Sex between my two parents who made me. The interactions that I have constantly with my students, or even the interactions I'm having here with you now. This is what we call the inter-individual level. Like, we are talking, we're having a discussion, and literally, within this ontology, after this lecture and the Q&A that will follow, neither of us will be the same person again. Literally, this is the case. In the same way, the bodies, they also, let's say, make up our body at the infra-individual level, are also constitutive of what we are. This glass of water, or the liquids that traverse our body, we drink it, or the food that we eat, literally, within this ontology, makes our part of our body. Okay, so in this sense, it's trans-individual, because all these levels, the supra-individual, the inter-individual, and even the infra-individual, right? It's a weird terminology, but let's say my lungs, which bring molecules of air, right, are an individual body inside my body, but they're also a body that connects me with the plants in all around me, because without the oxygen that they produce, I would be breathing, right? So this is what it means by trans-individuality. It means that any individual body is just a point in a network of connection that connects any single individual, not just me, but also this glass of water, which would not be the same without the glass that made it and without the water that has been poured into it, could not exist. Is that clear enough?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So, what is so interesting with this trans-individual ontology? Okay, first of all, since mental and bodily are not opposed, but are one and the same thing, as I said, not simply the food that I eat, not simply the material condition of my existence are, let's say, formative for what I am, but also my thinking. Also the images that we see, the images that I see in the New York subway, the disability campaign, the discourse that we are having now, all of this becomes particularly important in the creation of anybody's trans-individuality, okay? In particular, within here I'm drawing from the work of Moira Gattes, who's an Australian feminist, very much influenced by this kind of ontology, but also very much influenced by psychoanalysis and the idea of the imaginary. She emphasized how within this ontology, images of bodies are as important as bodies themselves. We always enter in contact with other bodies through a certain image of them. And it's precisely with the encounter that we constantly have with other body images that we come to form our own individuality, which again must be understood as a trans individuality, and in this sense as a body in plural. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So why do I insist so much on this idea of bodies in plural? Because I think this can really be helpful in bringing us beyond some of the aporias and impasses that have plagued feminist philosophy in the past few decades. First, by bodies in plural, I mean to underscore the trans-individual nature of the process of individuation itself. That is, of a process that keeps together all these different levels, but also at the same time, the processual nature of our own being. And in the, being a woman, as we see later on, doesn't mean to be one thing that is given once for all, but it's always a process, okay? It's not an individual, it's not an object given once for all, but it's a constant process that takes place through a series of network of connection that are all the different intra-individual, inter-individual, and supra-individual Secondly, by placing the body within an ontology, a monist ontology, one also gets easily beyond all the oppositions that have accompanied feminist debates. For instance, is the subjection of women the result of their biology, nature, or the result of their upbringing, culture? Behind this opposition between nature and culture, as well as behind the opposition between sex and gender, there is indeed the typically Western metaphysical dualism that centers around the body-mind dualism. But if we understand bodies beyond this body-mind dualism, clearly, and we understand body and mind as simply two different expressions of the same thing, clearly there's not even the space for asking the question whether the subjection of women is the result of biology or culture, because both biology and culture are mental and bodily at the same time. So in this way, we really go beyond this kind of position, and we also go beyond the position between sex and gender in the sense that both are at the happen. It's not that sex concerns your body or your genitalia, and gender is just society or the cultural bringing. Both are bodily and mental at the same time. Okay, so at this point, the question that is certainly lurking in your mind is, okay, if women are processes, right, how can we even say here is a woman, right? If it's this mess of connections and the intra-individual, how can we define a single individuality in space and time? Now, with an answer that combined literary theory with psychoanalysis, I would answer that it is a narrative. Right? The way in which we can keep together all of these interconnections is through a story. Mm-hmm. Now, a story, as all of you literary theorists very well know, is itself not a single object that is given once for all, but is itself a process, always, of storytelling. Right? So the story that we can say about, for instance, I can say about myself as being a woman includes both the stories that I've been told by other people about what it means to be a woman, the stories that are conveyed in icons such as those that we have seen before, but also the stories that I want to tell myself about myself, and also the stories that maybe I don't want to tell myself about myself, but I'm constantly exposed to. Okay? Now, notice here how within this ontology and within this understanding of woman as a process, we really go beyond, we have the tools to go beyond gender binary and gender dimorphism, right? We can include in the notion of womanhood all kind of women, right? In the position where I stand, I can, for instance, say that the story of womanhood includes potentialities and events such as menstruating, not menstruating, menopausing, not menopausing, being paid less than your male colleagues, that's almost always the case, but also being an intersex woman or being a trans woman, being somebody who's transitioning to from male to female or vice versa. The list is open, of course, and so every time we're exposed to new ways of being a woman, we can expand our horizon and our definition. But at the same time, here comes the psychoanalytic side of my research, it's not easy to accept other understanding of woman because they challenge, they tend to challenge what we have inherited from our culture, which tends to privilege gender binaries, first of all, and tends to privilege heterosexuality and therefore reproduction as what defines gender in terms of the binary. I mean, whenever you privilege the binary, it's because you privilege heterosexual sex being predicated upon basically the production of babies. Okay. So, how can we accept definition of womanhood that really question this gender dimorphism, whereas we as individuals are socialized in a system where this is constantly being penalized and object of discrimination? Here I think that artistic practices can be particularly helpful because what they do is that together with the critique, the rational critique, they are also usually able to add elements that we could call affective, right? There is an affective surplus in artistic practices that pushes us to question, not necessarily at the conscious, but also at the unconscious level, our inherited gender norms. And here I want to tell you a story of the way in which, for instance, the work of Laura Anderson Barbata has been, for me, a particularly insightful example of artistic practices able to question the established gender. Okay. So how many of you are familiar with the work of Laura Anderson Barbata? How many of you know the story of Ilia Pastrana? Okay, very few. Okay, so let me say a few things about it. Is everything clear up to now?
Yes.
Okay, and we still have time. Great. So the image here, entitled Julia e Laura, captures just one of the main works that Laura Anderson Barbata has been doing on the history of Julia Pastrana. What you see in this picture is a woman artist, the canvas on her back suggests the art, who's projecting herself as a mirror of another woman standing next to a statue and having a black beard. The two women have similar purple dresses, the same sort of pose, similar shoes and hairstyle, but one is wearing glasses and the other is having this thick, long beard. Interestingly enough, the woman artist without a beard is called Laura Anderson Barbata, which in Spanish, like in my own native language, is very close to barbuta, which literally means a bearded woman. Is this a woman on the right. Is the artist standing in front of the canvas the truth of the bearded woman on the left? Or is the break in the middle of the image suggesting a process of identification, but also disidentification between the two female figures, but also between the female figures and us, the audience? I would argue that it is both, and it is precisely by doing so that this image works as a means for interrogation and renegotiation of what it means to be a woman. Now, this is just one image. I'd like to focus on this, but Laura Anderson Barbada has been doing a lot of work setting up both plays, installations that reenact the story of Julia Pastrana. What is the story of Julia Pastrana? So we know very little about the beginning of her life. We know that she was born in 1834 in the small in a small village in the state of Sinaloa. We know that at some point she was living in the house of the governor of Sinaloa, where she was trained as a mezzo-soprano, where she was taught English and French. So trained in European arts. In 1854, so when she was 20 years old, she was sold to Mr. Francisco Sepulveda, who partnered with an American businessman, Theodore Lent, in order to showcase Julia Pastrana in the United States. So she was sold as a name. The same year, Theodore Lent married the very Julia Pastrana, and from then on, he became her manager and husband, and he started to showcase her not only in the United States, but all around the world with titles such as The Ugliest Woman in the World, The Non-Descript, The Hirsute, The Ape Woman, The Female Hybrid. These are all titles from advertisements. You're seeing on here only one of those advertisements. The Beer Woman, The Baboon Lady, The Monkey Woman, among others. Now, what is interesting is that she, like all the bearded women of the time, raised a huge interest. It was not just for artistic spectacles. She would give little spectacles, dancing and singing as a mezzo-soprano, so playing with the contrast between the beautiful voice, the trained voice, the worked out voice of the mezzo-soprano, and her bodily appearances that were presented as animal-like, right? So the monkey woman, bear woman. So it's precisely because of putting together these two elements that she was able to find the non-descript, right? So the monstrosity as such. And because of this, she was also object of scientific studies constantly. She was actually studied by Darwin. She was included in the Cabinet of Medical Curiosity. You can see here an element how medicine and exhibitionism went actually together in a story. Exhibitionism that didn't even stop after her death. She died after giving birth to a child who had the same condition. Here you can see their embalmed bodies. A Russian scientist bought the bodies from the husband, embalmed the body, but then Theodore Lent managed to get the bodies back when he realized that he could still make money by showcasing the embalmed bodies. So he kept going on shows with these two bodies until actually, and this is, I think, is an interesting fact, he actually met another woman, a Russian woman who had a beard as well, and he forgot about the Julia Pastrana story and went on doing with this other woman the same thing that he did with the first. So there's really a kind of perverse fascination and repulsion exerted by this kind of body, which I think for us is psychoanalytically very interesting. So it's not simply the refusal, but it's also the fascination for this body. So much that her very husband, we can say, simply was using her but not only, he also kept falling in love with women with the same condition, up to the point, the last news that we have about him is that he went insane, and so he was found in a Russian asylum, probably as a way for, this, I think it's important for us, to understand how difficult it is, mentally speaking, keeping together visions of womanhood that really question our established norms. This guy, besides exploiting Yulia Bassana, also literally went crazy. Now, what is this fascination of the story of Yulia Bassana that she clearly exercised at the time she was in? She lived, but even after her death, and that in a way she still keeps exercising. If this artist is now using her story and keep reproducing her story in all of her work. In order to understand this, I think we have to go back to the kind of exhibitionistic logic, which I think is an integral part of colonialism. Why do I say so? So here, this image, I choose this among all the others, because it's not just the strange feminine features which are shown, but it's also, as you can see from the name, she's also presented as the opaque Indian, right? So this being a name for colonized people. We're talking about, this was done in Western Massachusetts, so a site where the United States of the America were just being established. So it's the moment where the European settler have established their states, and it's the moment of the war on the Indians, right? So, and this is the moment when referring to the monstrosity of the opaque Indian, opaque being the name of a tribe, is a way for also reinforcing the settler colonial project that is happening at the same time. Now, how is this fetishistic and exhibitionistic logic working? It's working because by showing the colonial fetish as an exception, right, as a monstrosity, you reinforce normative view of femininity inside. And we know, I mean, what is so upsetting about the body of Yulia Bassana is just that it has a lot of hair on her face, right? Now, this excessive number of hair on her face was considered to be a monstrosity. Why would that even be such a monstrosity? Why is femininity incompatible with having hair on the face, right? This is if you think that the logic we are talking about was over. It's not. I mean, there is a way in which the displacement of body hair is indeed one of the crucial techniques for the production of gender roles. You know it very well across the spectrum. In particular, we may remember here that, as Paul Preciado notes in their amazing work, Test of Junkie, hirsutism as a clinical and mental condition, making normal women potential clients for normalizing cosmetic system, was invented at the time of colonialism. Right? Before the time, the number of bodies of hair on a woman's body was not considered to be a problem or something that would make one more or less feminine. But hirsutism as a medical condition was used both as an index of femininity, but also as an index of your racial belonging. So for instance, for an Asian race, only a certain number of hair are admitted on the body. So if you are an Asian, belong to an Asian race, and you have, let's say, the same number of hair on your body of a Mexican race, then you are considered to be an anomaly, right? So you can see how this example shows how, the example of the hair, right, shows how gender and race and colonialism, right? So also the inheritance of colonialism really coalesced inside of the same exhibitionistic and fetishistic logic. We're still there. Now, what is the work of Laura Anderson Barbata doing here? I think the work that it is doing is to enact what I call a counter-spectacle. Right? If it's true that colonialism has to rely on this exhibitionistic logic, on this spectacle that shows Julia Pastrana as this curiosity, this monstrosity, this monster that is showed around all the European and North American cities, the work that we see embodied, I think, in this Mexican-born but living in New York artist is a counter-spectacle. So what she does in her performances, she takes pieces of the spectacles by taking pieces of the advertisement, pieces of the story of Julia Pastrana, and turns it against itself. That's why I call it a kind of homeopathic strategy, in the sense that it still reproduces the same visual register, the same spectacular logic, but it turns it, so to speak, against itself. So much so that by seeing this image, you may either think about this, and why hair, the displacement of hair, is such an important defining feature of gender roles, or you can think about the inheritance of colonialism, right? And the way in which the exhibition of this opaque India, the misnomered word, as a way to reinforce the settler colonial project. So why art, this doesn't mean that art is the only way to do that, but I think the privilege of artistic narratives such as this one, first of all, Laura Anderson Barbata encountered the story of Julia Pastrana through a play devoted to Julia Pastrana in New York City. I encountered this work of Laura Anderson Barbata through a book devoted to Pastrana. So there is a way in which these artistic narratives, they trigger. First of all, I saw this image and I found it somehow unsettling. I thought, what is going on here? So as a way to trigger some sort of affective reaction, which is not simply the rational critique, right? So this image comes in white. It's not written above anything of all the thinking that this image has subsequently triggered, and of which I think you've already been talking. Okay, so is this clear?
Okay. Yes.
So I want to move here to the conclusions, which are also a bit longer than just racial conclusions. So be patient. Now, why anarcho-feminism? I want to focus on these two questions, why anarcho-feminism, and what it means to develop a form of feminism beyond Eurocentrism, or what we call feminism beyond the coloniality of gender. So why anarcho-feminist first? As we have seen, it has become a commonplace to argue that in order to fight the oppression of women, you have to adopt an intersectional approach and fight all kinds of oppression. Yet, in all of this literature, there's hardly, with just one exception, any mention of the anarcho-feminist tradition of the past, which in itself, for me, it's very strange. I mean, anarcho-feminist and feminists within the anarchist movement have been very important in all of the struggles for women's rights, certainly very much so in Latin America, but also in Italy, in all the countries where, let's say, industrialization was not highly developed, anarchism was one of the most commonsensical reference points. It's only later that, for instance, Marxism and socialism became more hegemonic. First time that, let's say, the Communist Manifesto arrived, for instance, in Italy, they say, okay, great proletarians, factories, we don't know what they are. So in a way, anarchism was able to speak to peasants and in a way that Marxism, for instance, being entrenched in industrialism wasn't. So why is this transition that, historically speaking, has been very important, never mentioned in feminist academic debates on intersectionality that are arguing exactly the same point? Okay. My contribution here, as I tried to say, is precisely to say we have to remedy this gap between intersectional feminism on one hand and anarcho-feminism, but we also have to do it in a way that doesn't create further hierarchies within the feminist movement. So besides historical accuracy, recovering this anarcho-feminist inside has, in my view, the crucial function of enlarging feminist strategies precisely in a moment when, as a consequence of the increased circulation of capital and labor force, we are indeed in a situation where the emancipation of some women in the north can happen at the expense of further oppression of women in the global south. And what do I mean by this? I mean phenomena very well known, like the care chain. So I mean the fact that in order for me to go and teach my fancy philosophy classes on gender and domination at the new school, I need to hire a nanny to look after my kids, and most of the time it's either Latino immigrants or an African American nanny, right? So this is what I mean. Literally, we have to be careful because feminism, emancipation of some white privileged women, means more oppression for other types of racialized and class-defined qualities. So in a times, indeed, where feminism risked being mere white privilege, I think that anarcho-feminism is more important than ever. I want to read you, for instance, a passage that at a time where I was in New York City and the whole debate was centered on Hillary Clinton as being, if we elect a woman president, this is going to solve our feminist problem. This was the debate. And at some point, as after a heated discussion with a colleague about whether Hillary was going to solve, was going to initiate a feminist revolution, I started to work on Chinese anarcho-feminist. And I read this very interesting work, unfortunately very unknown, by He Chen, who wrote a very important text called The Problems of Women Liberation. And I read you a quote from this. The majority of women are already oppressed by both the government and by men. The electoral system simply increases their oppression by introducing a third ruling group, elite women. If the oppression remains the same, the majority of women are still taken advantage of by the minority of women. When a few women in power dominate the majority of powerless women, an equal class differentiation is brought into existence among women. If the majority of women do not want to be controlled by men, why do they want to be controlled by women? Therefore, instead of competing with men for power, women should strive for overthrowing men's rule. Once men are stripped of their privilege, they will become the equal of women. There will be no submissive women, nor submissive men. This is the liberation of women. And notice here that, you know, liberation of women doesn't mean matriarchy, nor does it mean women taking the position that was once occupied by men, right? It means that there should be neither submissive women nor submissive men. The timelines of this work, written in 1907, show how prophetic anarcho-feminist has been. And here also comes, I think, an answer to the question why anarcho-feminist.
because I think it's the best antidote against the possibility that feminism becomes simply white privilege, or against the possibility that feminism becomes just an elite phenomenon. Indeed, in an epoch of the election of a single woman as president is called the liberation for all women, or when women such as Ivanka Trump can claim the feminist battles of the past and present themselves as feminist because her fashion brand is called Women Who Work. Not that I doubt she has ever really worked, but anyway, this is how she claims feminist battle of the past. The fundamental message of anarcho-feminist is more pivotal than ever. Here, for instance, a quotation from Peggy Corniger from 1671 is from a moment in the feminist movement in the United States where the term anarcho-feminist, like with the A, as a emerged as a way to feminize the movement. Like, so it's not anarcho-feminist, but anarcho-feminist. She wrote, "Feminism does not mean female corporate power or a woman president. It means no corporate power and no president." Right? Thereby meaning that it cannot be just a few women who manage to make it to the level of economic or political power and therefore keep ruling over the majority of women, but if feminism has to mean the liberation of women, it has to mean the liberation of all women, not just very few of them. And here also we come to the other part of my conclusions. What do we mean when we say all women? Okay, we have to mean all women around the globe. I mean, we live in a globalized time where you cannot limit your understanding of a feminist project, not just the project, but say the framework. Of course, any project can be local, can be very specific. Even just the work of a feminist artist in New York can be important for somebody. So you can work at all the different levels, but as a framework for thinking about feminism, and in particular anarcho-feminism, I think that anything less then the entire globe would be an unforgivable provincialism. Why do I say so? Because the feminist movement has been indeed monopolized by very few countries. That's why I call it feminist beyond Eurocentrism. The books that you read on in a feminist bookshelf are all produced, we can actually name them. France, Germany, United States, United Kingdom, maybe Italy and Canada. I mean, most of the feminist literature is produced in those countries, right? So at the detriment of all the important work that has been done by feminists around the globe, you know, Chinese, Latin American is very important on the anarcho-feminist side, African feminists, which has remained at the margins, right? So if we want to avoid it, feminism becomes just a mere white privilege, we have to also enlarge the framework for thinking about feminism. And in particular, we also have to keep in mind here the fact that the gender binary, right, the very notion of a woman, what it means to be a woman, the position between woman and man, is a binary that has been transported to the entire globe via colonialism and capitalism. I mean, there are a lot of recent native feminist studies. I'm more familiar with the US, but I'm sure there are the same also in Latin America, which shows how gender roles were much more flexible before the arrival of European settlers. We know, for instance, the Cherokee people had third gendering, so there was a way in which being a biological male or female didn't determine your gender. There was a much more flexibility, so there was a third gender, but there was also a different system for categorizing gender. My favorite example is the Yuma people, a tribe that used to attribute gender on the basis of dreams, basically. So if you were dreaming about weapons and hunting, you would become a man for all the purposes of social life. If you were dreaming about producing babies or agriculture, you would become a woman for all the purposes. But notice how these categories that we use, men and women, are actually categories that we import most of the time to this different setting, like pre-colonial setting. Another very important work, maybe some of you are familiar with it, in the field of African studies, Oyeronki, Oye woman, shows how, for instance, in the Oyo Yoruba culture, there was not even a term for, say, male and female. In their native language, the main criteria for classifying bodies was not your physical appearances, right? Whether you have a penis or not, whether you have breast or whatever genitalia appeared on your body, but the way for structuring society was most of all age. And age was not even attributed on the basis of visual signs, but much more so on the basis of the oral transmission of knowledge. Right? So all this to say that anarcho-feminism as a tradition has inside of itself precisely this more global vocation, and so I think it's more inclusive, not always, but we can work towards a more inclusive understanding of feminism, so also one that is somehow beyond women in the sense that we have to make a space for understanding of womanhood that even question the very idea of woman. To put in a slogan that began with the new global movement, another world is possible, we could say another woman is possible, but also because another woman has always already begun. We just have to be more open in our understanding, although this is not easy, but there are tools for thinking about these issues that goes really beyond Eurocentrism, but I think also beyond what we have inherited from colonialism. Thank you.
I spoke and then I said I was Mexican. So it was this So that really touched me when you say about this money's conception and ontology, because, you know, it's, of course, we are one as individuals, not dividing mind and body, but then there's all these different ways that the world has to read us. You know, these narratives are there to categorize us just by the way we look. So, and I was going to France, Fanon, you know, white, black skin, white masks, and all these things. So, having that, how do we, I mean, I guess my question is, if people who are racialized or targeted, well, conceived as women physically, you know, I mean, you are a woman, but then of course you're racialized, and then you, of course, you, there are all these, coming from an intersectional perspective, all these ways that we are immediately read as, but what happens when people are colonialized within and they're, you know, what they think is not according to what their physicality is, you know? And how, I guess it's from a decolonial perspective, how do we decolonialize our minds in order to act against this system that keeps colonizing us and putting us in a second, third, or whatever category that is? So how do we shift that and not, coming from a monist perspective, but also still recognizing that there's this binary logic, I guess, in a way, where body and mind do not correspond necessarily if we decolonize. So how to shape that and how to break that?
Yes, I mean, this is a great question. I wish I had a definitive answer as to the question how to shift the perspective, because then it would also mean that it would not be so difficult. I actually think it's much more difficult than we think. Okay, so first of all, Fanon is useful here. I mean, it clearly says ontology is not useful in this respect because it cannot account for the experience of being black, right? At the same time, so the project, as you've noticed, and that's why I also left the ontological part more on the side, does not, the monist ontology does not imply that we are always considered as equal. That's clearly not the case. It simply implies that when we look at bodies, instead of looking at them as single individuals that are given once for all, we have to look at them as a network of connections. And your example is very interesting in this respect, because the same physicalities, right, appearances, can count as white in one context and as black in another. Now, what makes that body black or white is not some individual property, but is the trans-individual context that associates a certain body with blackness or white. When I was traveling in Algeria and doing doing a research on body images, I was shocked, like all the cosmetic where advertisements are done on depict women who are really, 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 really very, very clear skin. Like none of the bodies in the streets around Alger or around all the Algerian city I visited correspond to that kind of very light skin images that the advertisement constantly gave. Now, what does this mean? I mean, at some point, I even asked, like, you know, when you buy, I don't know, you call it in English, the fondotinta, right, to make your skin or cover makeup, right? If it's a completely different type of skin, like, it's just not going to work if your skin is dark. Like, you don't need the same, you know, don't use even the same kind of item. So I was really puzzled. Now, how, if it's true that it's the trans individual context that assigns to the same person a different meaning as being black or white according to the context, how can it be that advertising always privileges a certain image of whiteness as
normative framework for what it means to be beautiful, right? Why is there such, I mean, and that's really worldwide, like all these makeup companies, they work worldwide, right? They also tried, for instance, I know, because a colleague of mine from the United Nations work in Peru, where they tried for a company who tried to make advertisement by using darker skin women, and they thought they work better because it would reflect the color of the skin of the people in the street, and then they had to go back to the white European models because the brand wasn't selling well. I mean, almost went bankrupt, right? So this means that shifting those models of beauty is really hard, right? And despite the fact that we are differently classified according to the place where we are, there are really global forces, and there are global images as well. They tend, and we know where this began, right? The privileging of the dividing of people according to different races began with European colonialism. It's not an a priori view of mine. It's not that whenever you see a body, you immediately have to think about a race or about being more or less dark skinned, right? The division of the globe into races and into people with red skin, yellow skin, brown skin, black skin, or more or less darker skin, all these colors, white, yellow, red, have the function of propping up whiteness as the implicit norm, right? Everything else is a deviation from whiteness, okay? So it's true that there are local contexts, but also, I think it's also true that we do live in a globalizing society where and more, wherever you go, you see that whiteness is propped up as more or less implicit, but as the normative idea of beauty and femininity. So this doesn't respond yet to your question of shift perspective. I've spoken already too much, but let's say what anarcho-feminism has to propose with regard to this is really to act on many different levels, okay? So political strategies, economic strategies, also individual strategies, right? Examples of queering, for instance, the family, living in social arrangements different from the European bourgeois mononuclear family. Another thing we learned from Fanon, right? The problem for those who are outside of the empire is not the Oedipus complex. Because if you don't live in that kind of setting, he says in the Antillean, people don't have the Oedipus complex. I mean, their problem is the neuroses of the colonized people who perceive themselves as white, because they watch Tarzan and they identify with the good guy in Tarzan movies, but then they discover that they are treated as black when they go to Paris, right? So this is their problem. It's not, I want to sleep with my mom or my dad, right? So we have to have a multiplicity, that's the anarcho-feminist project, that we have to adopt different tools for each different setting, but also adapt, let's say, keeping in mind what I would say is the global framework, which is inevitably in mesh with in what we have inherited from the colonial past. It's just the beginning. But also, keep in mind, the paper is called Towards an Anarcho-Feminist Manifesto, and I'm writing a book on this, so this is just the first step. I don't promise that I'll have a definitive solution by the end, but I have to say what I'm reading is really, and the more I research on this, the more I am, I have the impression that there's something very vital in that tradition, which is undeservedly left outside of the world.
I don't have a specific question, but I will try to explain what I'm thinking. I've been reading
for some months about Buddhism, about a little bit about indigenous religions in America, and I think they all have a common ground in that we are all one, like the beings, the universe, the everything, being one with the universe, being the cliche. And I've been thinking more about that, and I've been applying it on an individual level. But one of the contradictions of being one with the universe in that, in the spiritual sense, is that you have to stop defending yourself and guarding yourself and reaching for a false security in anything you could think of, like clinging to life, clinging to money. Like you, it's that sense of not living in made of worlds that are not really what your body is thinking or feeling. So, one of also some work of feminists is the vulnerability of the woman nature. Like we are, our relationships among women and towards other men and other gender representations is that we our strength is our vulnerability. But here in Mexico, it's difficult to be vulnerable when none of us can be sure that we'll return home when we go out of our houses in the morning. So we as women specifically are very targeted, and we have to defend ourselves all the time from all of those violences. So what I would ask you is, how are you thinking about being these bodies in plural? How can we drop our individual guard and function as plural beings, like a coral? I was thinking of corals of being like a, this web of beings. So how have you been thinking about teaching ourselves to drop that guard without being further victims of all these systems of oppression?
Yes, I try not to speak too much. This is a huge question, and there's a lot of it. So, first of all, we mentioned at the beginning the literature, I mean, Buddhist, indigenous religion, which emphasized the all being one with the universe. I have to say, this is what I found most fascinating, is that you read Chinese anarcho-feminists, right, who were writing in 1907, and they all begin in that context in the idea of the Tao, right? So Tao is philosophy, but it's always the same principle, like we are all one with the universe. You read Buddhist anarchists, and it's the same principle of interdependence, so different term, but the same principle, not the one of the Tao, but the interdependence of the Buddhist. And I've started to work on Latin American anarcho-feminists. Unfortunately, I'm working on my Spanish and hope to improve it. But what I noticed in a lot of anarcho-feminist projects from the 19th century, they all began with the idea of being one, right? So the advantage of anarcho-feminists, not by chance then a lot of anarchists were geographers, like Kropotkin or Reclus, they work with the environment. Right, the natural environment, so they're not stuck in national boundaries to begin with. But they also work with this idea of interconnectedness, right, that we're all interconnected, which, I mean, I use the notion of transindividuality, it goes back to Spinoza's philosophy, but you could very well give exactly the same paper using Taoist philosophy. I think it would not change. So, and what you said, it just reinforced my impression that there's a, behind all these anarcho-feminist projects, there is this emphasis on the being one, the interconnectedness of everything, right? Now, it's true that according to what you read, some Buddhist philosophy have an emphasis on distancing yourself from attachment, and therefore
not just your vulnerability, accept your vulnerability, but also a detachment from life, which could, I mean, in certain contexts, lead to a kind of apolitical retirement, right, in your own contemplation. And, I have to say, I don't think that's necessarily the case, so as I tried to show, there are actually people using the same kind of religious, spiritual, or ontological framework, you know, maybe philosophy is in this sense occupying the same space. And I really find it depressing that a lot of philosophy that goes on today, certainly in the United States, has become this technical work, which is completely detached from the big questions, where I'm saying, like, this is cheap in the sense, like, how can we look only at the small little thing when there are such huge questions? How can you, so to speak, use this notion of this framework when you have to go back home and you're not sure whether you're going to call an Uber to go? I'm experiencing, for instance, here, how differently the experience of real violence, right, on the body of women impacts, like, just generates level of anxiety that at times you have to deal with by retiring into some kind of individuality. So first of all, I would say that precisely the trans-individual framework help us understanding that it's not just you, right? The problem is not that you're wearing a miniskirt, so it's the problem is the whole system. And the moment we start to realize that this is the whole system, it's not just Mexican society or the violence that you experience here, it's the violence worldwide. That's why I think it's really important to keep the notion of feminism. I mean, we live in a time, 2018, it's still the case that we have women infanticide, right? So there are places around the globe where women at birth are killed because they're considered useless, right? That's not the same thing with men. So having a penis is an advantage, like globally, okay? So, and in a way, I think that this trans-individual perspective help us to realize that it cannot just be your daily battle, right? It has to be connected with what is going on more globally, right? And I mean, for me also, I have to say, this, I don't think, precisely because of this modern framework, I don't think that having a conversation, an intellectual conversation such as this one, is less important than go out and march in the street. I think both are equally important. And also, this work of debate that can help us to realize that, you know, we're all on the same boat is actually, and here we speak across the spectrum, because there's nothing that I hate most than when I'm told that, you know, feminism is a women issue, right? It's, we are all, the division of people into different gender and the heteronormativity, division into men and women, is across the spectrum. Clearly, it privileges certain type of gender over others, but we are all racialized and read through gender categories across the spectrum. So it's not perhaps a practical solution for to deal with everyday violence, but it's certainly an invitation to link our daily experience with the entire history.
I'll try to narrow them down. Yesterday I was meeting young